Appearing at the Reading and Leeds festivals in August 1999 would have been an important time for any band. But for Elastica, after 2 years of constant speculation about their future, it was particularly nerve-wracking. They were about to unveil new songs and a new lineup, and at Reading, they were about to go through their own personal judgment day.
I actually really did think I was going to have a heart attack before we did Reading. Everyone was just ashen-faced.
Reading was just, unbelievable. Nerves like I've never had before.
I threw up. I've never thrown up before a gig before. I think everybody threw up. The pressure was just amazing.
We were there 45 minutes on stage and only remember about 20 seconds of it and just remember just throwing up. I thought everyone else seemed to have thrown up before the gig and Justin managed to throw up during the gig as well.
Nervous. I shat myself.
Me and Justin were pulling faces and he was like, chucking up, bless him.
In a way, you need that much kind of adrenaline. I properly thought I might have a heart attack.
Since Elastica's first eponymously titled album became one of the fastest-selling debuts of all time, the band's career has plotted a remarkable course from triumph to near oblivion. Tonight we follow the story from singer Justine Frischmann's college days through to an exclusive preview of several tracks from the long-awaited second album, The Menace, which took 5 years to make and was very nearly never released. Elastica's origins were in the days of the new wave of new wave and Britpop, during which time, Justine was to become half of Indy's celebrity couple with Blur's Damon Albarn. But her first achievement was as founding member of another band entirely, due to a chance meeting with fellow student Brett Anderson.
I went to college to do architecture and Brett was doing planning. And I convinced him to move over to architecture, so they were in the same course.
Suede vocalist Brett Anderson.
Well, when I first met her, the kind of music that she was listening to wasn't very left field at all. It was kind of like she was really into sort of Joni Mitchell and stuff like that, and all sort of like acoustic-y stuff.
I'd be playing him Van Morrison, and he'd be playing me the Mondays and the Fall and things like that. And in the end, he won, and I just stopped playing him things and just started listening.
And we sort of started Suede, just playing with a couple of acoustic guitars in a bedroom with Matt, the bass player in Suede now, and a drum machine and stuff like that, and then we met Bernard and stuff.
I've been in Suede a couple of years and basically I was just keeping quiet and playing rhythm guitar.
This was before we ever had a record deal or anything like that, and she was in this very embryonic stage, the person that would sort of say where she thought we should be going and stuff like that. I think her influence on early Suede was really important, but in the same breath it was probably just as important that she left and formed her own band, really, I think, for everyone.
Brett and I both failed our third year at college and I decided to go back and redo my third year and he carried on with Suede, and then during that year Suede got huge.
I was born as a pantomime hall, ugly as the sun when it falls to the floor. I was cut from the wreckage.
I suppose I was a bit jealous, but more than anything, I think it made me feel like it was possible to get a deal and get somewhere.
I think a lot of the sounds that she wanted to get with Elastica were probably a reaction against Suede in lots of ways. I think that she wanted to do something a lot tighter and more modern sounding maybe than lots of early Suede.
Being in a band where I hadn't had that much input really helped in a way, because I'd got a chance to get frustrated and think what I would do if it was up to me. We did quite a lot of rehearsing before Donna joined the group, just Annie, Justin and I. And I definitely wanted to keep it simple, because playing guitar in a band with Bernard also playing guitar really made me kind of resent guitar solos and actually want to keep the whole thing very punky and to the point.
In June 1992, Justine Frischmann, her boyfriend Damon Albarn, and drummer Justin Welsh began jamming together at the Premises rehearsal studio in East London's Hackney Road. Annie Holland heard about it through the grapevine.
Mark Waterman was my best friend in Brighton, and he phoned me up saying that a band wanted a bass player. So I went up and met her. It was Justin, and that was it. Damon was there, who I didn't recognise at first, and he started playing bass, saying, "This is the sort of stuff we do." And because I'd never played bass before, I was just watching his hands and thinking, right, I can copy that. And lo and behold, they asked me to come back the next week, and I got into it and learnt to play bass.
The band were a three-piece until an advert was put in the Melody Maker stating, "Guitarist wanted. Influences, The Fall, The Stranglers and Wire." At the auditions, just one applicant stood out, a guitarist refugee from Wales, Donna Matthews. Here's Annie again.
Donna was brilliant. She couldn't stop talking. She was blaring on and on and on. She came in. We jammed some stuff together. And as soon as she left the room, it was thumbs up. She's great.
Already through her involvement with Suede and with Damon, Justine had met a number of music industry insiders. One was Mike Smith of EMI Music Publishing, who was persuaded to finance a demo by the new band.
I was absolutely staggered with the quality of the demos. I hadn't had anything that good in, you know, almost in the time that I've been working in the music industry. It was a real shock. The actual demos ended up being released as singles. They were such high quality.
As demos go, Elastica's first effort was one of the freshest and most gripping tapes of the early 90s. As a result, industry rumour about Elastica spread fast. Music journalist and former editor of Select magazine, John Harris.
It must have been late summer 1993. There were tapes going round, music journalists and the odd kind of what you call music business person. And they were like gold dust. Everyone said, "Have you got an Elastica tape?" And I managed to get one. When you stuck like glue. And I was kind of unaware that Justine was Damon Albarn's girlfriend or any of that business, I think, at that stage. I just thought it was great. When you're stuck like glue, Vaseline, when you're black and blue, Vaseline. British music was recovering, essentially, from a real doldrums period, and Elastica embodied that. When you're stuck like glue, they looked great, the songs were very, very good, and also they radiated a real excitement. If any of the groups at that time were in with a shout, they were.
Amazingly, for a band in such high demand at the time, they chose to sign to the small independent label Deceptive Records. As the head of the nascent company, whose offices were above a second-hand furniture shop in South London, Tony Smith recalls that it wasn't exactly a case of fat cat lawyers and 40-page contracts.
The deal was cobbled together in a pub in Camden called The Good Mixer, I think. I don't know how much you'd been drunk at the stage, but it was a pure handshake deal.
I don't think we'd even discussed money. It was just a handshake and a packet of peanuts and a cider, and that was about it.
I have to confess here that in my role back then as part-time journalist, part-time A&R scout, I was at that meeting, and I was the one who got the peanuts. Meanwhile, in the following months, Elastica supported the likes of Blur and Pulp on tour and released a limited edition 7-inch single, Stutter. Off the back of that, in early 1994, they won the Best New Band gong at the NME Brass Awards. So by the time they came to release their first widely available record, the expectations were huge. Even so, the group were a little taken aback by its march into the chart.
Lineup had come out, I think the midweek on it was 9 or something, ridiculous. And we were just going, "Oh my God, we're going to be doing Top of the Pops." We hadn't done a backing track without a vocal, so we had a playback to sing to. I remember, as we put it down, Mark Waterman saying, "Is it worth putting one down without the vocal on it?" And we were all like, "Yeah, we're really going to be on Top of the Pops for this, Mark."
Justin, who by now was in a stormy relationship with guitarist Donna, it was a bizarre situation.
We were squatting at the time, living in this place where the rain was pissing through the ceiling, and a limo turns up outside to take it off to Top of Pops.
The band's second commercial single, Connection, was released in October, entering the charts at number 17. In January 1995, the third single, Waking Up, broke the top 10. The debut album followed in March, and as the sales reports started trickling in, the nerves and excitement started to mount. Tony Smith of Deceptive Records.
We never truly believed that we'd be able to get to number one with an office, one person, no major capital behind us. We never set out to do it, but as it trundled along, it obviously began to feel possible. And when it happened, it was just such a wonderful feeling. I think that was kind of a defining moment, to feel that we could actually do it.
With a UK number one album to their name, America was the obvious next step for Elastica, and Stutter was released as a single to pave the way for an album launch. Many British groups, before and since, have conquered home crowds, only to find the States a much tougher proposition. But for Elastica, the bandwagon rolled on. John Harris.
I remember being quite amazed, because obviously Blur and Oasis and Suede and Pulp and all those people just weren't doing anything over there. And from nowhere, Elastica appeared to be doing very well.
We got Best New Band in Rolling Stone and we went gold and stuff. It was weird because people were sort of saying to me, oh, what have you been doing? You know, you lot have been really quiet. And I was just like, well, we've been in the States for 2 years and we've gone gold and it's all going really well. Nobody really knew.
America was proving a triumph for the band, but the rush to consolidate that success soon began to test the limits of their stamina. Personal lives had been set aside as they made huge journeys across the States, chasing a punishing schedule. Drummer Justin Welsh.
I mean, we did about 5 tours of America or something like that, and the idea of being a rock star, rock band, after a while got really tiring, I think.
If Justin found it tiring, bassist Annie Holland began to find it intolerable. When the band decided to fit extra UK dates into the middle of the American Lollapalooza tour, she told them she'd had enough.
We were being shipped from, you know, tour bus to hotel, and then photos, interviews, and then more photos, more interviews, and then you go in for a sound check, then you get photos and interviews. It just got ridiculous. And I said, well, that's it. As soon as I hit England, that's it. I'm not coming back.
Annie had left the band at the height of their success. As Justin recalls, this left them with immediate problems, although he could hardly have guessed how long these problems would last.
We came back to do Failure and Big Day Out. She left after the Failure gig. She wouldn't get on the plane. And I remember sitting on the plane, and there's a massive storm going on. It's just like, what the hell are we doing here? You know, why are we going back? We're back in America now with no bass player.
Among the other acts on the Lollapalooza tour with Elastica was Beck, who recalls the day that they came to him for a loan.
They didn't have a bass player, so they came in one day and they were borrowing my bass player. It's pretty funny. They ended up taking her. They swiped her.
Hole's bass player said she'd play with us. That didn't work out. And then we got Beck's bass player. And it just didn't work. We just felt like we were just going through the motions then.
The band completed Lollapalooza and toured Australia before returning to England, still without a permanent replacement for bassist Annie Holland. Despite the mounting expectations of a sequel to their number one album, the band seemed to have lost their creative edge.
I think the momentum just completely came to a crashing halt at that point. I mean, as far as I was concerned, everyone's saying to me, you know, where's the album? And I was thinking, well, we've only written 4 songs.
I don't know. But it's worse when it comes from your mates as well, and they're all still saying, you know, when's the record out? And you find yourself lying.
A few songs which were written at that time have survived to appear on the new album, including Image Change and Love Like Ours, and Human, which was written after Donna and Justine saw an inspirational gig.
Well, Human came out of that period of songwriting when the band had got back from our 2 years of touring or whatever. I think that was one of the New Order influenced songs. Donna and I had seen New Order playing at Reading, and it was one of the most brilliant gigs I've ever seen. If I was only human, all
Human from Elastica's forthcoming second album, recorded with a new lineup but written just after Annie had left the band. Having tried more than one replacement bassist, a chance meeting in a club led to the recruitment of Sheila Chipperfield. Sadly, the new lineup just wouldn't gel, and Justine became increasingly worried.
None of my songs had been really working with Sheila in the group, and Donna wasn't really up for doing my material. It just didn't really seem to be going anywhere.
Although they did secure a second new recruit, keyboard player Dave Bush, who had the impeccable pedigree of having been in The Fall, the British press were well aware that Elastica were in difficulty. John Harris.
We used to get these paparazzi pictures taken outside the Met Bar, and every week we'd get one of Donna in a progressively more ludicrous style of dress, looking thinner and thinner and thinner. So you didn't even take delight in it. A lot of it was really, really worrying, to be honest.
While the press seized on rumours and snatched photographs, the pressure began to take its toll on the relationship between Justine and Donna Matthews. To Justin, it seemed the band was in danger of disintegrating.
I think it was because both of them wanted to kind of be the front person of the band. Justine was letting Donna take the back seat for a while, and her take over, and then Justine wouldn't come into the studio and Donna would take over. And for the rest of the band, we didn't really know what direction we were going in, so it just kept falling apart.
Justine, meanwhile, had started writing with Loz Hardy, whose own band, Kingmaker, had recently split up. She soon began to find it much more productive than her efforts with Elastica.
I started doing demos in my basement with Loz, and we were thinking about maybe trying to put something out. I just thought maybe the Elastica thing was a sort of one-album project.
One of the tracks they worked on was an uncharacteristically intimate song called My Sex, a track which survived the difficult times it was written in and is now one of the most remarkable songs on the new album.
It's probably the most personal song I've ever written, and it's actually sort of remembering all the relationships that I've had that have gone down the drain, but rather than concentrating on the negatives, it's very much the perfect moments.
What I want.
Mornings for the winter and afternoons for the summer.
What I want.
Is for you to be waiting around the other side of every door.
What I want.
To walk through the wardrobe of other bodies that we have known. Funny, because I played it to Damon, and it made him cry. He shed a tear, bless him. It's better than him laughing at us, I guess.
Several songs now existed which would be central to the new album, if Elastica survived long enough to finish it. In the end, their future was tied up in a flash. Within a matter of days, they both gained one important member and lost another.
I bumped into Annie at a Blur gig in Brighton, and she said she really missed working with us, and you know, at that point I just thought, right, well, I'll give it one more try and we'll get Annie back in. Donna left a week later, and I just thought, okay, well, Donna's gone, and you know, we weren't getting on, so that was kind of like a relief for me.
According to Justine, Donna's reasons for leaving were made obvious.
She said to me, I don't like your songs, I don't like your voice, the way you play the guitar makes me cringe. And I'm going. And at that point, I said, good.
Justin Welsh.
Yeah, I loved Donna to bits, but in one way it was kind of a blessing in the end, because it stopped all the bickering and the fighting. Having Annie back actually totally inspired me again, and I was, you know, actually started finding myself as a musician playing again and really enjoying it.
Swapping Donna for Annie appeared to break the deadlock within the group. Although Justine was now facing her well-publicised split with Damon Albarn, the band went on to add both guitarist Paul Jones from Linoleum and Mew from Heave on keyboards and vocals. With the group rehearsing and fired up again, Justine was feeling optimistic.
I think we needed it to feel like it was us against the world again, and I certainly started feeling like that. It just felt like a challenge again. It was my thing again.
The first concrete evidence of this sudden thaw in the band's fortunes arrived last year in the shape of a 6-track EP. The vocals on the lead track were not by Justine, but by Marquis Smith of The Fall. Several other tracks were old demos and recordings from the last several difficult years.
Well, I did really want to get away from that thing of doing like a big comeback, and I think it confused a lot of people.
A flower falls, from your tears, flowing down. Quiet says this.
Journalist John Harris.
The EP that they released, the 6-track EP, I thought that was awful. I was just completely bamboozled by it.
groups have come back from time away and brought out LPs that are very like that, so they probably avoided that one. But it was very disappointing.
Brett Anderson thinks Justine was being a little optimistic.
I mean, the whole thing about that thing, I think, was a real attempt at not being a comeback. But, of course, you're never going to be able to release a record from being away for 5 years and people not to overanalyze it and stuff like that. You know, I think it was just a kind of little wave at people saying, hello, we still exist kind of thing, you know.
If the EP was a low-key attempt to rekindle the excitement of Elastica's early days, Justine feels the new album is closer to the spirit which made the original band so successful.
Even though some of the songs are much slower and sort of darker or whatever, I think, you know, I just wanted it to sound like Elastica, as, you know, people kind of think of us, which is hopefully quite sort of spunky and spiky.
Perhaps the most improbable track on the new album is a surprising cover of the 80s hit by Trio, Da Da Da.
Well, I found a little Casio keyboard in Portobello Market, and it had that original Da 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 drum machine on. And I took it into rehearsal, and I just started, you know, doing the Da 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 thing, you know, what you do and what you don't. And as I was doing it, I kind of realised how amazingly apt the lyrics were for what was going on the very well-documented relationship breakdown scenario, but even just the fact that it's DA, you know, DA, whatever.
What you do and what you don't. What you will and what you won't. What you can and what you can't. This is what you got to know. Love you though it didn't show. Ich lieb dich nicht, du liebst mich nicht. 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 Da, da, da. I know why you went away. Understand you couldn't stay. Wonder where you are today. After all is said and done, it was right for you to run. If you didn't need to lose madness. If you didn't need to lose madness. If you didn't need to lose madness. Leading me to this magnet. Da, da, da.
The title of the new album, The Menace, reflects the 5 difficult years the band have spent working on it. As they now wait to see how it's received, one thing they can be sure of is that it won't go unnoticed, because the press, at least, are thrilled to have them back. John Harris.
Justine is one of the kind of best pop stars we've had for the last 10 years or so. She's great in interviews, she looks great, she writes great songs, and she's very interesting. And as a journalist, let alone a music fan, that's the kind of thing that you would jump through hoops for.
As for the band's fans, this was their reaction after hearing the new material at their recent Astoria gig in London, a gig which regular Lamacq Live listeners will have heard on the show already.
Excellent, very good. I haven't heard anything for ages, but I'm looking forward to hearing the next album, definitely.
I thought it'd be a bit more exciting than it was. I thought Justine would be like a more kind of exciting performer.
I think some of the new songs are very brilliant.
It was very good. They're a bit retro. And her hair's too long.
I thought it was just like Rise Above Wire, but it's good. Yeah, it was very good.
Keyboard player should have been standing in the middle rather than at the side.
I thought they're much better now than ever. That new keyboard player is amazing. Great t-shirt she was wearing, superb, top notch, fantastic. Had a great time.
Fantastic record. It's Waking Up from Elastica, and that is from 1995.